I'm Bob Geller from the Boomtown Rats, and this is the first time. Probably the only time, but the first time. First single I bought was Good Vibrations. I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitation. Which was not my thing at all. It was just so complete and so wonderful, an idea, an entire opera in a couple of minutes. The first album I remember thinking was a record was my sister's album of The Shadows. As George Harrison said, no shadows, no Beatles. The Rolling Stones, you know, just standards like Route 66, but they weren't standards to me. I was a kid. In a sort of contemptuous insolence that they invested in the blues. Dylan's first album, which many people, well, they don't disregard, but I know not many people bought it, but for some reason I did hear it. The sort of psychology I understand it as now. Even now, if I listen to it, it's in the voice. Hey, hey, Woody Guthrie, I wrote you a song. It's a wonderful record. I mean, Freewheeling, obviously, right, is suddenly light years in something else. And so really between the rootsiness of the Stones and the first Dylan album, referred me back to John Lee Hooker and Howlin' Wolf, Muddy Waters, Woody Guthrie. In fact, they specifically said, listen to them. Like everyone of my generation, that really alerted me. It electrified me. So I wrote a song that became our first number one when I was working in an abattoir. I was just writing about the people around me. As I say, it wasn't just an abattoir of hopelessness for the animals, it was a slaughterhouse of dreams, you know. But the people in there, caught in this rat trap, caught in this hopelessness of Ireland in the mid-70s. I wrote down this thing that was a series of sentences approximating more a short story. I wasn't at no intention of being in a band, but come the moment they say, have you got anything else? And I said, well, I've been, you know, messing with this thing, and next minute it's number one. There's a book coming out. This is coming out in Favour, Tales of Boomtown Glory, same week as the album. And it's 40 years of lyrics, and having to find stuff and write essays about it, I found a really good song I remember writing. And I kind of remember its non-tune. Certainly that was a way that I found, even before I could play guitar, that here was a way of expressing sort of and framing references of, you know, what was going on in your head or in your experience. Halloween night, 1975. The first three songs, standard story, Petrified. I had my coat, my scarf, and my hat on. I wasn't about to take them off because I was sure we were going to be ejected at any point. It was in a schoolroom. We played on the teacher's dais, the platform. Maybe 30 people in the room. It started off disastrously. The guitar player was so nervous he played the wrong fucking riff to the song. So we just kept going with the wrong riff, and I made up a song on the spot that sort of suited the riff and brought it to an untimely end. Gradually, the sound of approbation filtered through my scarf and hat and fear, and I heard people clapping something I was doing for the first time in my life. And it's Ireland, Catholic Ireland in the mid-1970s, and a girl out of 30 people walked over and said she wanted to shag me. Now, I'd read about this in Protestant England and in sort of porn mags, but I'd never, ever, I didn't believe girls just came over and said they wanted to fuck you, because girls didn't have that sort of sex, and it was never going to happen. The career choice wasn't that difficult to make, you know, bang, you know, excellent drugs, beautiful girls, that was, I was off that way. I heard a song on TV before I saw on radio. It was Mark Bolan had a children's TV show in the afternoon because his career was on the down. So Mark had us on. He died about 2 weeks later. And I saw that on TV before I heard it on radio. The warehouse where you live in, I'm waiting on this, don't get too long. But actually, it's a good question, because it was much cooler hearing your song on the radio than seeing it on TV. I'd forgotten this. I'm excited suddenly internally again. I nearly exploded through the roof with excitement, you know. It went straight into the charts, and I called my father and, you know, and see if fucker I can do something. I was 10 or 11, and my sister was forced to take me to see the Beatles in a cinema in Dublin. I wasn't big on the Beatles. They were a sort of girly thing. I was excited because I wanted to see Helen Shapiro. I wanted to hear her doing Walking Back to Happiness, whoopa, oh yay, oh yay. Said goodbye to loneliness, whoopa, oh yay. But Helen had come on and had been less than devastating after saying to the sullen silence of all these assembled 12 and 13-year-old girls, you know. So she died a death. Next minute we heard bang, ch-ch, Ringo checking the drums, I suppose. And then a pointed boot stuck out under the drape velour curtains and the place went apoplectic. The lights go dim. Oh yeah. Tell you something. I was so scared. I'd never heard abandoned femininity. I'd never heard this banshee wailing. You know, I mean, so when you see the Beatles say we couldn't hear anything, we couldn't hear anything. You know, we paid the fucking money. We couldn't hear anything. It was terrifying, I mean, properly terrifying. Afterwards, directly opposite is the Gresham Hotel, we found what we now know as the service entrance. And it didn't really take us long to make the decision that being the Beatles, of course, they must be on the top floor. You know, where else would the Beatles possibly live? So when we got to the top of the hotel, we knock on the door answers, and there's this beautiful 19-year-old boy in a black waistcoat and a white shirt and his tie undone. It's Paul McCartney, you know, and we're going, Paul said, yeah, all right, come in. And so we go in and they are the Beatles. They're sitting around one table. And I put this now to the viewers and listeners and readers of Rolling Stone. What were the Beatles doing in 1964 in between shows in Dublin? They were personally answering the stacks of fan mail. George was a bit pissed off with Paul. He kind of went to him, give me a fucking break, you know? And Paul sort of kind of went, what? I remember that, and Ringo just didn't care really. So we were numb, and Paul was very kind. He said, do you want us to sign your thing? You know, so they signed it, and we lost the album.